much. Let's dig in now to the details of that DNC hack we were talking about and the motivation behind it. Hari Srinivasan is in Washington with that story.
Thanks, Judy. For that, I spoke earlier this evening with former U.S. Ambassador to Russia, Michael McFaul. He's now a professor at Stanford University. And Thomas Ridd, who joined us via Skype from Austria. He's a professor at King's College London. He's written extensively about cyber attacks and digital security, most recently in his book, The Rise of the Machines. Gentlemen, thanks for joining us.
Hi. Great to be here.
Thomas, I want to start with you. First, lay out the evidence for us. We've heard that this is the Russian government. How do we know that this was Russia? How do we know that this was a sophisticated act that might take a state actor?
So there are two bits to the evidence. The first is who hacked the DNC. The second is who gave the emails to WikiLeaks. On the first bit, who hacked the DNC? Imagine a burglary and you find fingerprints in a house. And then you find the same fingerprints in another house, and you know who breached into one house but not the other. That's a bit the situation that we're looking at here. So we have IP addresses, we have server infrastructure, we have certificates. So quite strong evidence to say that the DNC was actually hacked by groups that are associated with Russia.
Well, Michael McFaul, are you convinced that it was Russia? Is this the way that they operate?
Well, first, more generally, Russia has tremendous capability in this domain. I worked in the government for 5 years. I witnessed it. I saw it. And we should just all say that first. Second, the reports that we have, just like Thomas just said, are very suggestive that it was two different Russian entities. The organization, the company that investigated it, CrowdStrike, was rather definitive in their analysis that they published a month ago, by the way, not just a few days ago. And now today, we have many senior U.S. government officials also confirming that they have strong suspicions that it was these Russian entities.
Mr. Ridd, I want to ask, you know, is this consistent with previous hacks that the Russian government might have orchestrated? Does this fall within their definition of what is allowed within how they carry out cyber warfare?
So the Russian government and intelligence community have been hacking and breaching adversary computer networks for a very long time, literally for 20 years this year. But this is the first time that they breached a system and didn't just exfiltrate, take out data, but then started putting those files into the public domain in order to affect, in this case, a democratic election campaign. That's new. That's a game changer, I think. So stealing, yes, but dumping into the public domain, that we haven't seen before. Can I just add a bit of an international perspective here? We have the same entity that was caught in the DNC's networks was also caught in the German parliament in the Bundestag in May 2015. The same entity was caught in a French TV station and actually interrupted their programming around the same time. It was caught in other European military networks, and the attribution is actually quite strong in those cases. The German government has come out publicly and pointed the finger at Russian military intelligence.
Michael McFaul, why would Russia want to do this? What are their interests in publicizing this intel if they were, in fact, the ones that acquired it in the first place?
I think there are two different kinds of arguments to think about here. One is the policy argument. There's no question in my mind that the Kremlin, President Putin, and others have said this rather clearly, in my view, that they prefer Trump to Clinton in terms of his policies. He said things that they like. But there's another element that I don't think has gotten as much attention, and that is that this is also personal. If you go back and you look at what Vladimir Putin and others said back during their last electoral round, they criticized Secretary Clinton personally for what they alleged was her meddling in their internal affairs. She criticized a parliamentary election back in December 2011. She said it was not free and fair or had problems. I don't remember the exact statement. And Putin then said she incited, I think the word he used, gave protesters a signal to come out and protest against him. So Putin's a guy that remembers these things. Maybe that's another explanation for why they're seeking this tit-for-tat now.
I want to pick up on something you said a little earlier, is that this sort of intelligence tradecraft happens all the time, that we are probably participating in some of it, some country, somewhere. Is the difference, then, that it's happening to the United States?
Well, I would put it somewhat differently. Let's be candid here. Do we really believe that the DNC is the only organization in the United States that the Russians have hacked? No, I don't believe that. They have an active operation here where they're constantly seeking to gather intelligence. What's unique about this is that they were caught. And that they were exposed. And number two, the data dump. I mean, that's the thing that is really striking to me. And that it was released on the day before the opening of the Democratic National Convention, that's not just coincidence.
Thomas Reid.
So I think it's really time for the United States government and the intelligence community in the U.S. to pull its weight and also draw a line here. Because indeed, as Michael McFaul said, this is a very significant incident. A lot of countries in Europe are looking at this and thinking, oh my God, if they get away with doing this to the Americans, what are they going to do to us?
All right. Thomas Reid, author of Rise of the Machines, Michael McFaul, former ambassador to Russia, thank you both for joining us.
Thank you.